facial recognition, targeted ads, image recognition, video analysis, anomaly detection. These are all powerful AI applications you must already have heard of at least once. But do you know what they all have in common? They are all using the same type of neural network architecture, the convolutional neural network. They are the most used type of neural networks and the best for any computer vision applications. Once you understand these, you are ready to dive into the field and become an expert. The convolutional neural networks are a family of deep neural networks that uses mainly convolutions to achieve the task expected. As the name says, convolution is the process where the original image, which is our input in a computer vision application, is convolved using filters that detects important small features of an image, such as edges. The network will autonomously learn filters value that detect important features to match the output we want to have, such as the name of the object in a specific image sent as input. These filters are basically squares of size 3x3 or 5x5, so they can detect the direction of the edge, left, right, up or down. Just like you can see in this image, the process of convolution makes a dot product between the filter and the pixels it faces. Then, it goes to the right and does it again, convolving the whole image. Once it's done, these give us the output of the first convolution layer, which is called a feature map. Then, we do the same thing with another filter, giving us many filter maps at the end, which are all sent into the next layer as input to produce, again, many other feature maps, until it reaches the end of the network with extremely detailed general information about what the image contains. There are many filters and the numbers inside these filters are called the weights, which are the parameters trained during our training phase. Of course, the network is not only composed of convolutions. In order to learn, we also need to add an activation function and a pooling layer between each convolution layer. Basically, these activation functions make possible the use of the backpropagation technique, which basically calculates the error between our guess and the real answer we were supposed to have. Then, propagating this error throughout the network, changing the weights of the filters based on this error. Once the propagated error reaches the first layer, another example is fed to the network and the whole learning process is repeated, thus iteratively improving our algorithm. This activation function is responsible for determining the output of each convolution computation and reducing the complexity of our network. The most popular activation function is called the ReLU function, which stands for Rectified Linear Unit. It puts to zero any negative results, which are known to be harmful to the network, and keeps positive values the same. Having all these zeros make the network much more efficient to train in computation time, since a multiplication with zero will always equal zero. Then, again, to simplify our network and reduce the numbers of parameters, we have the pooling layers. Typically, we use a 2x2 pixels window and take the maximum value of this window to make the first pixel of our feature map. This is known as max pooling. Then, we repeat this process for the whole feature map, which will reduce the XY dimensions of the feature map, thus reducing the number of parameters in the network the deeper we get into it. This is all done while keeping the most important information. These three layers, convolution, activation, and pooling layers, can be repeated multiple times in a network, which we call our conv layers, making the network deeper and deeper. Finally, there are the fully connected layers that learn a nonlinear function from the last pooling layer's outputs. It flattens the multidimensional volume that is resulted from the pooling layers into a one-dimensional vector with the same amount of total parameters. Then, we use this vector in a small fully connected neural network with one or more layers for image classification or other purposes, resulting in one output per image, such as the class of the object. Of course, this is the most basic form of convolutional neural networks. There have been many different convolutional architectures since LeNet 5 by Yann LeCun in 1998, and more recently with the first deep learning network applied in the most popular object recognition competition with the progress of the GPUs, the AlexNet network in 2012. This competition is the ImageNet Large Scale Visual Recognition Competition, RLS-VRC, where the best object detection algorithms were competing every year on the biggest computer vision dataset ever created, ImageNet. It exploded right after this year, where new architectures were beating the precedent one and always performing better, until today. Nowadays, most state-of-the-art architectures perform similarly, and have some specific use cases where they are better. You can see here a quick comparison of the most used architectures in 2020. This is why I will only cover my favorite network in this video, which is the one that yields the best results in my researches, DenseNet. It is also the most interesting and promising CNN architecture in my opinion. Please let me know in the comments if you would like me to cover any other type of network architecture. The DenseNet family first appeared in 2016 in the paper called Densely Connected Convolutional Networks by Facebook AI Research. It is a family because it has many versions with different depths, ranging from 121 layers with 0.8 million parameters up to a version with 264 layers with 15.3 million parameters, which is smaller than the 101 layers deep ResNet architecture. As you can see here, the DenseNet architecture uses the same concepts of convolutions, pooling, and the ReLU activation function to work. The important detail and innovation in this network architecture are the dense blocks. Here is an example of a 5-layer dense block. In these dense blocks, each layer takes all the preceding feature maps as input, thus helping the training process by alleviating the vanishing gradient problem. This vanishing gradient problem appears in really deep networks, where they are so deep that when we backpropagate the error into the network, this error is reduced at every step and eventually becomes zero. These connections basically allow the error to be propagated further without being reduced too much. These connections also encourage feature reuse and reduce the numbers of parameters. For the same reason, since it's reusing previous feature maps information instead of generating more parameters, and therefore accessing the network's collective knowledge and reducing the chance of overfitting due to this reduction in total parameters. And as I said, this works extremely well, reducing the number of parameters by around 5 times compared to a state-of-the-art ResNet architecture with the same number of layers. The original DenseNet family is composed of 4 dense blocks with transition layers, which do convolution and pooling as well, and a final classification layer if we are working on an image classification task, such as the RLS-VRC competition. The size of the dense block is the only thing changing for each version of the DenseNet family to make the network deeper. Of course, this was just an introduction to the convolutional neural networks and more precisely the DenseNet architecture. I strongly invite you to further read about these architectures if you want to make a well-thought choice for your application. The paper and GitHub links for DenseNet are in the description of the video. Please let me know if you would like me to cover any other architecture. Please leave a like if you went this far in the video. And since there are over 90% of you guys watching that are not subscribed yet, consider subscribing to the channel to not miss any further news clearly explained. Thank you for watching.